please stand with me as we stand upon the words of this confession of faith? Just a reminder to you, you know, it's easy to just get into a robotic saying of these words, but these, we believe these words to be true, rooted in Scripture, and it's our common confession of faith. Confession means to agree with. We agree with the Lord that these things are true. So let's confess our faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and is seated on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. What a list of things that we said we believe in are true, flowing from Scripture. And so we worship the Lord in standing on the truths of God's Word. Another way to worship the Lord is to give up your tithes and offerings as this, the mission of King of Glory, goes forward. So there's a basket in the entryway, or you can give online at our website as well, as you worship the Lord in that way. So I invite the worship team to come and lead us in a time of worship and praise as we prepare to hear the sermon this morning.
Reading from Ephesians 2, verses 8 through 9. For it is by grace, yes, grace, you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God. Not by works, so that no one can boast. Let's thank God for this amazing grace and worship Him now. Thank you. Prince. We can't save ourselves, Lord. We thank you for that amazing gift of grace. You're the pastor here, unless he brings us here. In your holy name.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And I've become accustomed to starting every sermon like that. I think that came from a sermon preaching through these letters and seeing that that was often how the Apostle Paul started his epistles or his letters to congregations. Grace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And today we happen to come to the very last section in Colossians, where he often would start by saying, grace to you, and then he's going to end by saying, grace be with you. As the Apostle Paul wraps up his letter to the Colossians, this is a standard for the Apostle Paul. Grace to you, and then grace be with you. Grace upon grace upon grace upon grace. He was a preacher of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I want that to be true of my ministry, to preach grace to you, grace being with you. And as we come to this last section of Colossians, I'm thinking of next week we'll start a new sermon series, which I just want to give you a little bit of an insight into how that has gone for me in my ministry to preach through books of the Bible like this. And each time it comes for the next book of the Bible, I take a time in prayer and reflection and looking through the list of scriptural books of the Bible and asking God to direct us where we're going. And I guess I share that with you today because this is the last time I'll be doing that here at King of Glory. And as I think of, this will be, and next week is the start of the last sermon series, and we'll be walking through Ephesians. And the other reason I share that with you is just as I wrote that down and mapped that out, I just had a moment of just breaking down and weeping in my office there. Just so grateful for you all and grateful to bring God's word to you and for us. And so grace upon grace upon grace. We receive God's grace. And I'm so thankful to preach God's word this morning because as we look at this text, as you open with me to Colossians 4, verses 7 through 18, I don't know about you, but I've heard of many people, they read sections like this in the Bible where it's a list of names and that sort of thing, and they just dismiss it, just kind of brush past it. But I get the blessing of sharing that with us today. And I think that as we reflect upon this text that we're going to have before us, Colossians 4, 7 through 18, it's reminding us today that ministry, the work of the kingdom of God, the work of the church, is about people. Real people, even people with hard to pronounce names, which I don't want to see any snickers and laughs from you because you're like, okay, Pastor Brett now gets to pronounce all these names in the text before us. Okay, go ahead, you can laugh at me because I mumble through all of the names, these Greek names that are hard to pronounce. But don't let that get past the fact that those names represent real people. I was talking to a few of you recently, and I mentioned if the Apostle Paul were to write a letter to King of Glory, he would probably mention your name in that. It's an interesting to think about. Congregations are about God's people in God's place. And there are literal congregations in the New Testament. Colossae, that's the name of the town that this letter was written to, the church in Colossae. In that ancient town. And so, we come to see that ministry is about people. And what is God doing in and through people? And you know what? Sometimes it's messy. We're going to see that even the list of, there's about a dozen people listed in this text in Colossians 4, 7 through 18. Not every story turns out really well. Some of it is kind of messy, and there's sin, and then there's brokenness, and there's even falling away from the faith that happens in some cases. So, let's turn to Colossians 4 and have this grace with us. That grace extends to actual people. And so, we turn to verse 7. in Colossians 4. And the first person that we have is a brother by the name of Tychicus. Hey, Tychicus. Can you say that with me? Tychicus. All right, I didn't want to leave you completely off the hook, right? I'm pronouncing the names. You can too, right? I'll teach you, right? Tychicus. Okay, good. You're with it. All right, so Tychicus, verse 7. Apostle Paul, as he starts to give his final greetings to the church at Colossae, he says, Tychicus will tell you all about my activities. He is a beloved brother and faithful minister and fellow servant in the Lord. I have sent him to you for this very purpose, that you may know how we are and that he may encourage your hearts. So Tychicus, isn't this a blessing to hear how the Apostle Paul speaks about brother Tychicus? He calls him a beloved brother and a faithful minister and fellow servant in the Lord. Tychicus, but most likely was the man that was entrusted to take the actual letter that Paul wrote to the Colossians and travel to Colossae and deliver it to them in person. Most likely it was Tychicus that, I don't know however you imagine that, I imagine him kind of galloping in on his horseback, but probably not. He probably just walked and delivered. Can you imagine? Tim, a congregational president, can you imagine having a letter from the Apostle Paul? Here you go. You know, entrusted to you guys here. That's what Tychicus did. He was called a faithful minister and a fellow servant of the Lord. You know, just this last week, or maybe a little over a week ago, somebody asked me, what does minister mean versus the name pastor? Is there a difference? The word minister literally means a servant. So, hey, if you want to call me a minister, great. That's great. A servant. A pastor means a shepherd. You know, somebody that shepherds sheep. But the word minister could be applied to people that didn't have the office of pastor. A servant, in other words. Kind of like we would use the expression the ministry of defense. The ministry of defense. You know, basically a servant in that realm. And Tychicus is called a faithful minister and a fellow servant in the Lord. And as we get started in walking through these names that represent actual people, I want to give us just a reminder of the Apostle Paul's MO. As he did ministry, it seemed like he never went anywhere alone. He did not do ministry alone. He was always pulling a friend here and a friend there, and a faithful minister from that congregation and traveling over here, a lot of his missionary journeys. He never did ministry alone. The Apostle Paul was equipping the saints. He was bringing them along in the work of ministry. So I apologize for not always doing that well. I've done that in the past where I've taken somebody along like on a visit or something like that. I think that's a healthy thing, because ministry is not about one person. It's about a group of people together. The role of a pastor is to equip the saints for the work of ministry. That was the Apostle Paul's disciple-making strategy. Ministry was multiplied as he pulled in all of these friends into the work of ministry. And it's kind of fun to see the eclectic bunch of people. They're from all different places. One of the men here in this text is from Thessalonica. They're kind of pulling from all over the place in his ministry work. He would pick one or two from each town and say, hey, come along with me as I go to the next town. And so, while many of those people go unnamed in the Bible, you get guys like Tychicus who can say, my name made it into the Bible. What a blessing that would be for Brother Tychicus to have his name listed here and a couple other verses in the Bible as well. So we get to the next guy, verse 9. Okay, so Tychicus was going to relate how Paul is doing to the Colossian church. Remember, Paul was in kind of a house arrest sort of situation. He was in jail, but people could come and go and visit him. And then the next guy is Onesimus, all right? Verse 9, and with him, Onesimus, our faithful and beloved brother, who is one of you. They will tell you of everything that has taken place here. So Tychicus and Onesimus took the Apostle Paul's letter to the church at Colossae. Now, you may be familiar with Onesimus. Onesimus is the subject of one of the books of the Bible by the name of Philemon. Okay, Philemon is a short book of the Bible, and it's a story of a runaway slave who came to Paul in prison, and what came to faith in Christ while in prison with Paul, and was being released back to his master, or his boss, in other words. And the Apostle Paul wrote the book of Philemon to... Philemon was the boss, and Onesimus was the worker, Onesimus. And Paul said, treat Onesimus well. I know he did you harm, but he has come to faith in Christ, and he is a changed man. And now it appears that Onesimus was being entrusted a lot with Tychicus in this important mission of delivering this letter to the church. I mentioned that ministry is about people, which means there's often some brokenness and some, shady past. But guess what? God can use our shady pasts as we repent, and as we are changed by God's grace, we are different people. And that seems to be the case with Onesimus. He became a runaway fugitive slave in jail. He has a rap sheet. And now he is saved in a new man, Onesimus. And here Paul says he is a faithful and beloved brother, a testimony to the change of God's grace. He was a trophy of God's grace, this Onesimus. Can you say his name with me? Onesimus. There you go. Next time, whoever gets to read this section in scripture reading, you're going to nail it. Right? Onesimus. Tychicus, Onesimus. Doesn't get much easier. Verse 10. Aristarchus. Aristarchus, my fellow prisoner, greets you. Aristarchus was in jail with Paul. He was hanging out with Paul in jail, probably in this somewhat of a house arrest. That's probably the best way to describe it to our modern ears. Not necessarily like in a jail cell, like we would think about it, but kind of like with an ankle bracelet on the leg. You can't go far, right? Aristarchus was with him. We know from history that Aristarchus was from Thessalonica, right? The letter to the Thessalonians, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians. Aristarchus was a man that was a fellow prisoner. He wanted to say, hey, how are y'all doing, right? He wants to send greetings. Make sure, tell the Colossians I says hi, right? That's Aristarchus. Verse 10, the next man. All right, this is easy. Woo! Mark, yes. Not one of these hard to pronounce Greek words. Mark, verse 10, Mark, the cousin of Barnabas. Aristarchus, my fellow prisoner, greets you, and Mark, the cousin of Barnabas, concerning whom you have received instructions. If he comes to you, welcome him. Okay, so the Apostle Paul had this guy, Mark, which... You know what happened with Mark? You can go back and read. And he's also known as John Mark. When Apostle Paul was launching off into his missionary endeavors, he and Barnabas had a rift. They fought over this guy, John Mark, who was a cousin of Barnabas, right? A relative of Barnabas. Paul said that Mark deserted him for the sake of the gospel. It's messy, right? It's messy. When we're dealing with people, John Mark was a deserter. He didn't want to go with Paul. And Barnabas and Paul clashed about that. But it appears that there was reconciliation. That God had done a work of grace to have them speak to each other and to reconcile and to keep working together. It seems that Apostle Paul sent a message of how to deal with Mark. Maybe there are special instructions. Handle this guy with kid gloves, in other words. He is a faithful minister as well. He's part of God's kingdom too. Which, by the way, reminds me, as we talk about ministry being about people, I'm sure all of us, I know all of us have sin in our background. Maybe God is laying on your mind a friend in Christ that, just like with Mark and Barnabas and Paul, there was a rift. And there was this kind of you left that situation without kind of closing, tying up loose ends. Maybe the Lord is reminding you that His ministry is about people. Maybe there's somebody you need to go to and say, would you forgive me? Would you forgive me? Even if you think that they need to do something, go to them. Say, would you forgive me? Let's seek to be reconciled. Paul somehow got reconciled with John Mark, and they were able to work together for the sake of the gospel. John Mark. All right, who's the next guy? Verse 11. Can you imagine if your name at this time in history, if you were named Jesus, and you became a Christian? that's this guy that's before us. It says in verse 11, and Jesus, who is called Justice. He felt so convinced that because Jesus Christ was his Lord and Savior, that he needed to go by another name. Jesus. Call me Justice. You don't call me Jesus. That name is the name above all names. The name at which every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. Paul describes these men, Aristarchus, Mark, and Justice. Verse 11 says, these are the only men of circumcision among my fellow workers for the kingdom of God, and they have been a comfort to me. In other words, Aristarchus, John Mark, and Justice, these were Jewish men who came to faith in Jesus Christ. They were of the circumcision, in other words. Paul was blessed by these brothers. These brothers had a gift of bringing comfort to the Apostle Paul. They are fellow workers. Did you catch that? They are fellow workers of the kingdom of God. Can I impress that upon you and us today? That it's not just the pastors that are the workers for the kingdom of God. It's the whole congregation. I want you to go away from this text as we talk about ministry being about people, of having that identity that you can say this in your mind and in your heart. I am a worker of the kingdom of God. If you want to write that down and tell yourself that this week, I am a fellow worker of the kingdom of God. These guys had the gift of being able to comfort, right? Everybody has different gifts and abilities, and those guys happened to be a great comfort to the Apostle Paul. Don't you love this? Paul is like, I love all these guys. He has good things to say about all of them. And so we continue here with more people. Right, I mentioned there's about a dozen or so in this text. It says in verse 12, the next guy, get back to those Greek-sounding names, Epaphras. Say that with me. Epaphras. All right, Epaphras. It says in verse 12 and 13, Epaphras, who is one of you? A servant of Christ Jesus, he greets you, always struggling on your behalf in his prayers, that you may stand mature and fully assured in all the will of God. For I bear him witness that he has worked hard for you and for those in Laodicea and in Hierapolis. Epaphras, he is a fellow Colossian. He is from Colossae. And most likely, he was the founding pastor of the church at Colossae. In chapter 1, verse 7, it says that you guys have learned it from Epaphras. Most likely, Epaphras was Pastor Epaphras. How would you like that? Pastor Epaphras. You have to say that all the time. You see, Epaphras' heart for the Colossian church, he's praying for them. He is struggling for them on your behalf. He is struggling in his prayers. He says that you may stand mature and you may be fully assured in the will of God. Epaphras was a fellow servant of God, teaching and praying for the people in the congregation. We need that too in our churches today. Verse 14, next guy. Whew, easier one. Luke. Luke, the beloved physician, greets you. This is the insight we get into Luke. He is called the beloved physician. Don't you love that? Ministry is about people, and it's everybody's different. Everybody has their own skills and abilities. Luke is like this precise doctor. He's Dr. Luke, and he will tell you, he will give you the full account of how things go. Guess what? Luke wrote two books of the Bible, the Gospel of Luke, and part two is Acts, the Acts of the Apostles. And in each of those, he says, I'm going to lay out a detailed account of the things that have happened. Right? Can you imagine Dr. Luke with his, you know, spectacles, kind of, all right, then this happened, and then this happened. If you like that kind of detail, Luke and Acts, the part one and part two history of Christ and the church is an excellent, of course, it's God's word, it's an excellent resource. He is the beloved physician. Okay? He's the doctor of the group. Dr. Luke, he greets you. Verse 14, the next guy, as does Demas. And this is the man, I mentioned that, you know, some of these might have fallen away from the faith. We know from history that Demas deserted the faith. He fell away from the faith. But at this point, at the writing of the letter, he wanted to greet the Colossian church too. Sometimes people fall away from the faith. As much as you would want to keep everybody in the faith, as a pastor, as much as I want to keep everyone in the faith, sometimes people either fall away from the faith completely or get frustrated and leave. Demas is one that fell away. May that not happen to any of us. May we stay firm in the faith. Most likely Demas was a guy that walked away from Christ. Verse 15. A generic group of people. It says, give my greetings to the brothers at Laodicea. Okay? Another group of people. The brothers at Laodicea. Which, by the way, Laodicea is one of the seven churches of Revelation. Shameless plug, come to Lent services. Laodicea is the last one. And so we'll hear about the church of Laodicea on Good Friday. That's the last of the seven. So, Laodicea. The brothers there, they say, hello, how y'all doing over there in Colossae? We're doing well over in Laodicea. We send you greetings as well. In verse 15, another person, it says, and to Nympha and the church in her house. Nympha, tradition shares, it's not exactly, they're not exactly sure if this is a man or a woman. It's equivalent to if we would say, greetings from Pat. Is Pat a guy or a girl, man or woman? Not exactly sure without giving you more detail. That's kind of the same way with this name, but most likely it was a woman who hosted a church in her house, in the house church. It says that into Nympha and the church in her house. Okay, Nympha also sends you greetings. All right, so verse 16, he says this. And when this letter has been read among you, have it also read in the church of the Laodiceans. See that you also read the letter from Laodicea. So this letter was to be read aloud. And as much as we take it a little chunk at a time each week, they read this letter out loud probably all at once. Guess what? It takes 13 minutes to read aloud the book of Colossians. That's kind of cool. That's probably what they did. They got the letter from Paul, probably a congregational president or the pastor there, maybe Pastor Epaphras, unrolled the scroll from the Apostle Paul and just read it all the way through. And that's good too. It's also good to take it chunk by chunk and digest the truth that God has given to us. But it would take just 13 minutes to read the entire book of Colossians out loud. Okay, there's a few more people here. Verse 17. And say to Archippus, or Archippus. We'll say Archippus. Can you say that with me? Archippus. Baby name ideas, right? So say to Archippus, see that you fulfill the ministry that you have received in the Lord. Okay, this is a special message to Archippus. Archippus was the type of guy, he needed a little bit of a kick in the pants. Do what you're supposed to do, right? See to it that you fulfill the ministry that you have received from the Lord. Okay? Some people are eager beavers. they do what they're supposed to do even before somebody even tells them to do it. Archippus was a little bit sluggish. Come on, Archippus, let's go. Come on, you can do it. See to it that you fulfill the ministry that you have received in the Lord. All kinds of people, right? And finally, cannot get past the last one, Paul. Verse 18. I, Paul, write this greeting with my own hand. I don't know if you knew, but here's a Bible weird for you. There's a type of person that was kind of the one that actually wrote down. Apostle Paul would say it, and this guy would write it down. He was called an amanuensis. That's a fancy word for the scribe. Okay, Paul would dictate what to write down, and he would write down. And Paul apparently had, he wanted somebody to do that. And most likely he had some sort of eye condition that prevented him from really seeing very, very closely. But this last verse, he says, I, Paul, write this with my own hand. And I'll see him dipping the quill into the ink to write. I write this with my own hand. And listen to what he says. He says, remember my chains. Remember my chains. Don't forget about me, Paul says. I'm in jail for the sake of Christ. Remember my chains. Today, we have brothers and sisters in Christ who are chained, for the sake of the gospel. You can go to the Voice of the Martyrs. There's another resource where it lists, there's an interactive map where you can see the countries where it's hardest to be a Christian. We have brothers and sisters in Christ around the world that are in chains. And so in the spirit of the Apostle Paul, we remember their chains. And then the very last words of the letter, grace be with you. Grace to you at the start of the letter, grace be with you. And when the Apostle Paul says you, no doubt he had in mind the individuals that made up the Colossian church. That's the same for us today. Grace be with you. You who are a fellow worker for the kingdom of God. Right? Did you write that down? I am a fellow worker for the kingdom of God. Grace be with you. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. Thank you for these actual, real people that existed in history and in these places. Thank you for using them in their unique personalities and their unique giftings. Thank you, Lord, for even working through the hardships and the messiness of relationships and the messiness of sin, being sinned against and doing sin, and even for those who are brothers in Christ who fall away from the faith. Through it all, Lord, may your grace remain with us as we take on this identity of being fellow workers for the kingdom of God. Bless King of Glory and all the people that are represented here, that you may make us mature in your grace. We'd be growing, serving you, willing to serve, and however you have gifted us. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. As we just received from God's word, grace be with us. Let's sing about that grace. Let's sing number 522, grace greater than all of our sins. Number 144, in the large print. Number 522. Thank you. Let's stand as we pray the Lord's Prayer and as we go with God's blessing this morning. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive this benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.